Hello everyone and welcome to our Masterclass episode number 5 and another huge episode for us. This time it is with DevM, a huge player in the Company of Heroes franchise, and he has just finished third place in this year's World Championship 2020, in which we followed him in a couple of series. This game against Loveness was one of the really impressive ones. So DevM, firstly, how are you?
Hello everyone, I'm good. How about you, Stormless?
I'm very well, and always an absolute pleasure to do something like this with you or cast one of your games. If anyone's interested, by the way, the games that we're actually looking at right now, the full series can be found in the YouTube description. DevM, let's waste no time getting into this. Please tell me a little bit about USF and the commander that you've chosen.
Just before that, I just want to talk about real quick the capping order coming into the screen right now. So you have the rear echelon on the top, and this is kind of a detail that I use on a lot of maps where I go into the front lines so I can see if the sector is being capped, and I kind of know where the enemy is going to in the map. So that's just a detail that's important in many maps that you can use. But yeah, so the build order. So basically the idea is that you want to out-tech your opponent, and because USF has a lot of great light vehicles, you kind of want to rush to them and use their advantage on the map to snowball into an early Sherman. So you want to time your M4C Sherman to be on time for the austere Panzer IV.
Very ambitious.
Yes.
And I mean, that in itself is not without some teching risks, right? So I think
exactly.
When we see you play this, you play the lieutenant, you don't play the captain, which leaves you without AT guns when you play USF Mechanized. So
yeah.
It's really, I think we spoke about this a bit before, was about huge early game map dominance.
Yeah. So you usually go captain in this build if you know that you're not going to be having that Sherman at the time of the Panzer IV. And I think you could see that in some games of the World Championship, where captain started
those.
Being used. Yeah, I think on the finals, for example, you could see a lot of captain just because US player didn't feel comfortable in having that Sherman in time. But yeah, into the game. So basically I saw that Loveness didn't go for the south wheel, he went for the north one, and I tried to stall him with the rear echelon on the building. And basically what I'm trying to do here is a pincer maneuver. Because I saw that he had the grenadiers away from the MG here on the center VP, for example. The idea is that he usually wants to use two riflemen and kind of gang up on one of the grenadiers and take him out of the field. And then you can move onto the MG, basically, because you're going to have numbers advantage.
So is this kind of like perhaps a weak start for Loveness in not keeping the grenadiers with the machine gun? Or is
yeah, I would say so. It's basically a mistake for him, I would say. Because right now I can... Yeah, you can see that the two riflemen are going to win this engagement. Mm-hmm. And that's because that first grenadier basically went back to base for free.
Right.
And yeah, so
how you've been kind of controlling the map here at the start, and actually one of the things that I always notice is that you go very very deep into enemy lines to get these territory cutoffs, and kind of focus on a lot of resource denial quite early on.
Yeah, so usually you have to kind of play stealth to do this. You can retreat the units early, like I could retreat that rear echelon or rifleman. Mm-hmm. And reinforce it and have it back on the field in time for when Loveness has his grenadiers back on the field. Or I can take this time to actually decap his points and cap for me. And the point is that he's going to come back stronger into the field, but on the long run, his 2-2-2 is going to be more delayed.
Sure. So, I mean, actually, you kind of maybe stall his advance by forcing him to recapture points as well.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I noticed that you're just taking it now, the munitions point. You're going to get double fuel here, which is amazing. But I'll say, like, there's no focus on kind of like early munitions and stuff. I don't see a grenade tech yet or weapons rack. So what's the, you know, with riflemen, let's just say that you didn't have this great early start and you took a lot of suppression and stuff. And what's the What's the way out of this when this goes wrong?
So it's not over, even if you, obviously, if you get those early bad engagements. I would say your way out is to still keep going at the fuel of your opponent. So basically, focusing diminutions against Austere is not going to grant you much, especially against the usual meta of rushing light vehicles. And I would say that usually start focusing munitions more going to the mid game, because then, yeah, you're going to have the BR upgrade and maybe the grenades by then. And before that, you don't want to use the resources to do those rifleman upgrades, because you want this to work as fast as possible, so for so you can counter this inevitable 2-2-2 that's now on the field.
This isn't even a quick 2-2-2, I feel. It's kind of like appearing at 6 minutes is slow, but it has a massive impact. Yeah. You're Stuart, though, at 6 minutes, like 17 seconds. I mean, is this really quick on time for you, or is this is considered like really fast?
Yeah, I consider this a fast steward. That early game went quite well. Just the 2-2-2 was delayed because Loveness didn't go for the usual Ostrupen, and usually that would mean the 2-2-2 comes about a minute earlier. But you do have the bazooka from the Lieutenant to counter that.
Sure, yeah. So I guess another thing that was interested by is okay, so I'm just seeing you getting healing up, which is quite, I don't know, quite late maybe, but obviously you seem to be putting a lot of focus into other things at the moment. But how are you really doing this without healing the squads fully? When they're going into these engagements, they're obviously going to be at lower health. I mean, what's...
Yeah, so usually because you go swords first, you don't have the healing right about on, you know, the 7 minute mark, I would say. What you do is use the double C51 and the stewards to kind of be the front line and make the grenadiers retreat, and then you back up with the rifleman until you are healing.
Gotcha. Okay. Oh, so this is actually woven into the strategy, which is interesting because you know, it's funny. It's really reliant on the timings of these vehicles coming out and being being on.
Well,
the field,
it may seem very fragile in the sense that if you don't have those timings, you're kind of screwed. But right. It's not really like that. You do have some leeway. But on, you know, in a perfect game, you do want those timings to be on point.
Sure. So what's in some of the games that we saw in the World Championship, and actually I'll look at say someone like Nagano when we watched him play USF, and actually he was going for grenades very, very early on as part of his build, just to try and force, in his case it was Ostrupen, I think maybe he's trying to force them out of cover and stuff, but I mean what's your take on still putting that into a strategy, going early grenades, early weapons rack?
I would say that it's possible but risky. So the idea is fine. Usually Ostrupen do need the MG to work against riflemen, and the grenades are just the perfect counter for that. But if by any chance you don't do very much with the grenades, that fuel that we expended for that is going to really hurt you, in the sense that you're not going to have the stewards in time for the 2-2-2 as well.
Sure.
And if I recall correctly, in the World Championship it did work well for Nagano, to my surprise, because usually Zildur is very good at dodging grenades.
Yeah. Yeah, credit to him. He got some really good, really good grenades during his series. Okay.
So, right now, I would say my comfort zone, because I have the steward out, I have the healing, and everything I have to do now is kind of bleed him out with the steward and the double C51. You can see that he's really not contesting the north fuel. And I do the MG because even though they are usually defensive unit, they can also be used to push them up offensively with enough support, and it kind of locks down. You know, it makes him it harder for him to actually contest field. He has to work more for it, and that will in the end delay before even more, because you can see that right now. Yeah, he doesn't have field. The MG is there.
I mean, what would your other options be? Because your unit retention has been very good. Just saw a good AT gunshot in the WC-50.
Yeah, I'd say that was quite lucky.
Yeah, it's got to happen at some point, you know? And so, but actually, let's just watch this with the scout car. I thought this was unfortunate during the tournament that you tried to dive in against the scout car. It was a good time, but are you worried about telemines here? Because the echelon's back in base.
Not really. I believe I had a minesweeper, and I do this thing where I kind of try to creep track where his pioneer has been on the map, right. And I kind of follow his steps before going there with the vehicle. So if he went left with the pioneer earlier, then before bringing my vehicles there, I kind of make sure that my rear echelon with minesweeper goes there as well.
Right.
But right now, I think that I had pretty good pressure on the center. Not sure if I used the minesweeper there, and because of that, I knew that he didn't have time to place the mines.
Right, gotcha. Okay. Yeah, because your map presence has actually been very, very present, let's use that word.
Yeah.
You know, it's you have been able to see a lot and keep track of a lot and know where those units are. Interesting. It's interesting that you actually follow the position of that and keep track of it. There aren't many players in this game, I think, that play to your level. When I've spoken to you, I've always felt like, okay, like DevM's thinking about things that I never hear other people talk about, you know. And I remember back in like GCS2 when I used to like watch these riflemen. And I was like, oh, you know, Devon's really, he's like they're just about to hit Veterancy 1, and he's like running forward to these light vehicles, trying to like hide the fact that he's about to snare them. And it, like, that's cool, do you know what I mean? Actually, there are more people thinking that way now than there were, and, you know,
do we that's true.
Credit that to people like you doing things like this, where we talk about your strategy, and, you know, it's cool that you're being so open about it.
The devil is in the details, always.
So,
Right now, I would say that the strategy is working to perfection. And even if right now I started losing badly, the damage is already done. He has been denied a lot of fuel, so his Panzer IV is going to be delayed by a lot. So my focus right now is in mirroring where he's going with the units, because usually when you lose on one side, like he lost the south engagement, he couldn't get that fuel. You kind of try the other side, you know?
Right. Yeah.
So the MG shifted to the center because it's closer to where he's probably going to go next time, and I just kept like maybe one rifleman on the south, and then I kind of mirror where he's going.
Would you actually say that, like, central map control, especially on a map like Nexus, would you say central map control is important? Because whenever I look at this game, I think if you're spearheading your opponent, you know, then it's like, it's very easy for you to go north and south to respond, and you get that bit of vision maybe towards the base where you can see where they're going or detect first. I mean, like, are there any kind of, like, map considerations like that that you think about, or is that fairly irrelevant?
Yeah, there are. Usually, it's the same concept that I used early game, where I sent the rear echelon to the center to see more or less which part of the map is going to use. And the same can happen mid game. If I'm thinking about doing a big push, I usually, for example, use my less useful unit like the rear echelon to still go through the center and see where his MGs or units are placed, then the rifleman go in. And right now, can kind of see that go on. The rear echelon was in the center, and I kind of kept it there for longer, and that allowed me to see more or less where his units are, and then I could do this push on the pack, which was really misplaced.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate that's going to go down here for sure. And I have to say, I mean, like, you're up against an insanely good player. Lovenest is, you know what I mean, it's the winner of many tournaments like yourself. So this isn't a kind of a game where you have, I would say, like a huge edge over your opponent. This is kind of like top level. And so, you know, this is all really interesting when you see these pushes and you see, like, how the opponent's handling it.
Yeah.
you know, is really cool. What I would ask you is, and I think this is an interesting perspective, is what are your weaknesses at this point in the game? Like, what do you fear coming up against right now with a lead like this?
So basically, the fear you always have with this strategy, and I guess USF in general, is if the game slows down too much and if you start trading too badly with your units. So I would say my fear right now is not exactly the B4, because I know that I delay the B4 by a lot. It's if he, for example, gets maybe a second MG and starts playing more defensive, and I can't breach that position.
Okay. Yeah. Who knows, you may have been forced to use some kind of indirect fire.
yeah, exactly.
which we never see. That's actually interesting, because you know, I think a lot of people struggle with USF aggression, especially in auto match. It can be overwhelming if your opponent's slightly better than you. So it's an interesting point. Slow the game down. Perhaps sit. Would you say like sit on a VP and fuel and a couple of MGs and just try to wait it out for a vehicle? Is that kind of what you're saying?
Right. Because at some points those grenadiers with the V3 and the G43s are going to start trading fairly well with riflemen. And it's at this point where the riflemen trade better with grenadiers, when you know they don't have G43s, you start getting the vet, you have the BARs, so you kind of want to push that into your opponent and do favorable trades of manpower. And right now the Sherman, yeah, it's on the field super early. This is like a perfect Sherman. The P4 isn't even out. And he just now used these vehicles to obviously trade free damage onto them, because obviously vehicles will not make you lose manpower in any way.
It's interesting, like, you're also perhaps not giving veterancy away as well to your opponents. Do they gain veterancy when they fire at vehicles, actually, or is it only minimal?
I think they do, yeah.
Oh, okay.
There's also the fact that I didn't talk that that's been happening quite a bit, which is usually the Austere player as a P-Gren. And P-Grens don't have the snare, so usually you want to pair up the unit that goes against the P-Grens. You want it to either be the Jeep or the Steward. So my Steward has kind of been going around following that P-Gren as well.
Okay, so you're kind of assigning a role to each of your units then.
Yeah, you could say so in a way.
right. Panzer Grenadier spotted, WC-51 and hotkey goes over. I like that. I think that's quite cool and quite advanced, actually. So what's the this is interesting. So where's the confidence here with the Stuart? I see you going in for the medic bunker.
Yeah, there's
quite long range as well, actually.
There's two things, is that the Stuart has quite a lot of vision when he gets veterancy. And the second thing kinda goes hand to hand with what I said earlier, which is I knew that because he lost the other side, he was not coming out this side. And when you are so far behind as Austere, you kinda want to clump your units together. So I knew, like, absolutely his base would be free right now. And I also know that Stuart can take the bunker quite easily. So I just did it. I assigned the Stuart there and the rest of my forces to the left.
I really hope I never have to play against you again. If I do, I hope you're playing some faction you never play with. But I mean, this is like, it's so well thought out, actually. And even kind of the analysis of what the opposite faction can do is really cool. You have both grenades and weapons rack unlocked right now, so
yeah.
You're just able to be really, really menacing with those. You're just about to see the Panzer IV come out. Is there anything, like, when you see the Panzer IV come out, you breathe a sigh of relief, or...?
Well, not really. Because even if he's super behind in tech, Austere with the P4 plus pack combo, it's still quite good. You can basically deal with about anything with that. But in the sense that it came so late, it's kind of a relief, I guess, because I know that I'm basically ahead one full Sherman, which is a lot.
Yep. So, I mean, what's, you're two Shermans now, I mean, is it... Talk to me about the 76mm Sherman, because I see a lot of people diving for this option over a standard Sherman. I mean, what's the benefit of having these right now over, say, Sherman Jackson or double Sherman wide 276mm?
Yeah, the benefit is that they are better than the usual Sherman to fight off Panzer IVs, and they can kind of complement the usual aggressive playstyle that you do with this rifleman with BARs and smoke pushes, because obviously you can't, you know, go around the pack with them, and they usually can be out of the cone of fire of the pack, fighting the Sherman all alone. I mean the P4 all alone. They also have smoke, so it helps with the rifleman clearing up the pack as well. While if you went for something like a Jackson with the Scott, it's more of a static playstyle. Mm-hmm. And you kind of have to be more patient with that. And I would say actually that style usually pairs up worse, or rather plays up better against OKW.
Yeah, it's, we know that too well, DevM.
Yeah.
If anyone wants to see that in action, check out the, what was it, the semi-finals, I believe? DevM loving that semi-finals.
Yeah, I think so.
Lower bracket, that was what it was, the lower bracket comment. There'll be a link to that in description as well. But yeah, I mean, this has been a really like impressive game so far. You have lost a couple of units now, you know, obviously, so which I noticed that your focus is not necessarily on going for infantry, it's more about pumping out more and more vehicles. But it is, you know, obviously you reduce yourself from capping power, but what's the idea between just pumping out the vehicles here?
Yeah, so if you have the fuel, it's preferable to just go for the vehicles. If you have like a mix of fuel and manpower, then you really can't afford to lose as many infantry units, I guess, or it puts you in a worse position. So right now, if my fuel situation was worse, I would probably try to rebuild those units and try to do a mix of know, push with the rifleman and the small amount of vehicles I have. Mm-hmm. But if you do have the fuel available, then I wouldn't rebuild the infantry and just go straight up for full-on, you know, vehicle battalion, you could say, to push your opponent. Because they're always going to trade better in manpower. It was what happened here. So at some point here, I lost, like, maybe, I think, two infantry units, two grenades on retreat, I think, to the P-Grin. And my thought process was stop being as aggressive with the infantry so I don't have to reinforce as much and use that manpower to put out maybe three Shermans out and then rush his position and end the game right there.
Sure. Can we talk hypothetically about this game in a different scenario where, okay, maybe you had a good start and then the mid game your opponent kind of came back onto the field quite strongly? Like some of the questions that I saw people perhaps asking during the World Championship Series, when you come up against, let's say your opponent manages to get two Panzer IVs, or they manage to tech up to tier four, like Panzer IV Panther. A lot of people still not building units like the Jackson. They just would rather pump out the 76mm. I mean, do you believe that that is correct, or would you ever say the Jackson's needed? What are your thoughts on late game, you know, versus late game Austere?
It's kind of a tricky question because it does have a lot of answers. Mm-hmm. It depends on the map and the faction you're playing against and the build of that specific faction. I can say that all can work in their own way. So you can have many M4C Shermans, and if you are confident on your rifle pushes, you can use kind of the smoke that the Shermans provide to help them push and clear the packs, and then use the packs to help you deal with a Panther, for example. Mm-hmm. That's one way to do it. And again, highly depends on the map. Open maps are harder to execute this. Mm-hmm. And then you have the second option, which would be Jackson paired up with Scots maybe and play the long game. And maybe wait for diminutions, for example, if you're using airborne to do a push or to use it defensively. And then You have the third option, which, for example, if you didn't go airborne and you don't have that ability, you can back tech to captain, use M4C Shermans to trade well with the enemy infantry, and then use AT guns to keep the Panthers at bay. Mm-hmm. And again, each have their own strengths. For example, Isildur, I think, is a bit like me in the sense that he prefers the approach of spamming M4Cs and do good rifle pushes and try to get that back for yourself.
Yep.
But again, it's about evaluating what's happening in the game and if you think that you can do that, if you can execute that. For example, against Love Nest, on that semi-final game against OKW, because Crossroads is a very hard map, in my opinion, to push once you get to those late stages. Like, you retreat back to base and you can get back into the field so fast.
Right.
Especially OKW, it has that tier 4 kind of holding the ground. It's hard to do a significant push. So all you can do there, or probably the best approach, is to play the long game and bleed him out and eventually have enough Jacksons to deal with about any vehicle he brings out.
Yep. Interesting. Interesting to know there's like so many different varieties and
I would say that, yeah, I would say like out of the three of them, the last one is probably the one of last resort, I would say, because even though AT guns are good, they are susceptible to the same thing that I talked about, which is if the Aussie player or Axis player pushes and steals your AT gun, then you are very vulnerable. Especially if he decks for Panzer Warfare, which I think Isildur did do against Nagano in one of the games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's the less preferable one, but it's the one that sometimes you just have to do because you either have no fuel and you do need the AT guns or the M4C spam plus pushes just aren't working. So you just have to go for something that might work.
Yeah.
But they're still, you know, they're all good options in their own way.
Okay. If we're just talking about some of the earlier game stuff, because it's obviously the early game is over so quickly, it's hard to always talk about that when it's happening. Right at the start, I mean, I typically see you when you go into a game, you pick a commander immediately. And I ask this question to everyone. Do you go in with a strategy where it's based on, it doesn't matter what the opponent has, I believe this is the best choice for me, or are you going in expecting something?
So it depends. With this commander in specific, it has the cheap early game that you need to use, then you need to pick it early. And usually when you do have like a set strategy right from the get-go like this, where you know you're going to do that 100%, then it's more about knowing the ins and outs of the strategy, like if I get behind, I need to go captain and all that kind of mind stuff.
Yeah.
But if we were, for example, if I was playing against OKW, which isn't very used, or if the meta wasn't so restricted at the moment with just usually like two commanders being used over the whole tournament, my mindset would be more adaptive. So I would have I would have to react mid game more, and I wouldn't have like a set strategy. I would say that when you do have a set strategy like this, and you know very well the ins and outs of it, it's probably where you're going to have, you know, the most chances of winning it all. So for newer players, for example, I would suggest that they do go into the game with a set strategy in mind and start knowing the ins and outs of those strategies.
Right, yep, I got you, understood. So, all right, DevM, somebody who maybe is just starting their Company of Heroes journey right now, and best of luck to those people. what are your What are your three commander picks for USF? You know, for people who are perhaps looking to spend the available supply coin that they get for perhaps, you know, I think you get 30,000 for joining to Relic. So there's a lot of videos out right now on, well, you know, what to buy, what to spend on. What are your commander picks?
Again, I can't predict the future. I can't say if this commander will in some way be changed, but I would say first one, Mechanized. Mm-hmm. Because right now it's just so good, you can really snowball the early game with the Jeep. I would say my second favorite is Airborne. Basically, it really helps you fill the gaps where in your tech when you are missing some kind of, either captain or lieutenant. And it has like a super useful late game ability, probably one of the best.
Yeah.
I would say my third choice is, I don't know exactly the name, the one that has the Wolverines, which one, what's it called?
You know, I know.
You know, the one that was used to... the one that was used before to crash infantry like crazy.
Well, it's not used for a while. Like, what's the name of this commander? It was used in a tournament
constantly.
Yeah, like...
assault engineers. I'm not quite sure what the name is right now, but I think it's quite a good commander because it helps with the playstyle of rushing in.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the equivalent of the T-34 playstyle, but for USF, because the tanks are so cheap. It's 90 fuel,
yep.
And they are really good AT as well.
Right.
So. It's a commander that's really good in the scenario that even if you get behind in fuel, you can get some kind of AT vehicle out, and it's really cheap and you can spam them.
Right.
And the assault engineers themselves aren't also half bad, I would say. So.
Okay.
Also, it has, I think, pretty sure the upgrade for the Sherman that gives it more HP at some point.
Right, yeah, do you mean like the bulldozer attachment? Is that...
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know what? It's really bugging me now that I can't. I know the face of the commander.
The worst part is that that's the commander they gave my face to.
DevM has actually had this commander with his own custom commander face put on it after winning the Warpaint Championship in 2016-17? Can't even remember what that one's called anymore.
It's because I haven't used it in a good while. But yeah, I would say it's still a really good commander. That and the Airborne one, I would say, are usually the best ones. This one has kind of appeared more recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, if they don't change this commander, then this is top one. But I would say those two are one tier below.
Awesome. Okay, well, I think... I haven't got any more questions. Perhaps just some parting tips if you have anything interesting that you want to let the community know or think is quite cool that you know is quite recent and relevant.
I don't think there's any quite recent tip I can give. I can say though that for any USF players out there, that they should really usually. Like, the most important part, I feel like, for USF is obviously the early to mid game, because it's when you are going to snowball the game. And I can say that, for example, some general tips against factions that I find really useful. So, for example, let's say you are up against OKW. Your early game, you kind of want to scout out where Eastern Pioneer is and kind of single him out. Because usually the OKW player always does the same thing, which is send the Stern Pioneer to the fuel point. Mm-hmm. And they can either do one of two things, depends on the player, and that's why that early scouting with the re-rational is important. So the OKW players usually either send one Stern Pioneer alone, in which case you send two riflemen to deal with it and kind of win the early game from there on out. It's really a big advantage to have the Stern Pio back to base so early. Or they usually send the Stern Pio, and the first Volk goes with the first Stern Pio. And in that case, you single out the third Volk that usually goes to the other side of the map.
Right.
So that's one of the tips I would say that's really good for early game, and can give you a really good advantage. For austere, it's usually more about not tracking the Stern Pio, it's rather tracking where the MG is going.
Right.
And usually it's done about the same way. You know that either if it's an Ostruppen build or a Grenadier build, one of the first units is going to be the MG, even before the tier 1 is built. And usually the MG is sent along with the Pioneer, because the Pioneer gives a lot of vision to support the MG. And if you can kind of scout out where the MG is going, you have kind of the same choice that you do with the OKW, where if he sends the MG with the Pioneer alone, you can kind of use the first two riflemen to flank the MG and send it back to base, again giving you a big advantage. Or if he sends a Pioneer plus MG plus Grenadier, you can look out for then the single Grenadier that's going to be on the other side of the map, for example.
Right, gotcha.
Awesome. So those are some early tips, yeah.
Yeah, good tips. I'm sure everyone's going to be really grateful for that. I am too. I'm going to play that myself for a while, and I'll let everyone know how that goes. But that's about it, DevM. Thanks very much for doing this episode 5 masterclass. This is like a masterclass and a hugely dominant game against an amazing player. And of course, you knocked Love Nest out of the tournament.
It was a very tough.
Well played. It's an absolute pleasure to cast your games in the World Championship, and a pleasure to have you on the Masterclass Series finally.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. All right. Well, everybody, DevM is going to give me after this some links or anything, if it's social media or stuff that he wants you to follow, or where you can find him and keep up to date with him. I will drop those in the description of the channel. So, you know, do go and give him your support, follow him, check out what events he's doing. And yeah, that'll be it. Then see you guys for the next episode of Masterclass. And we don't know who that's going to be with yet, but we'll make sure it's awesome. DevM, thanks again.
Yeah, thank you for having me yet again.
All right, ta-ra.